trials here, trusting in my Father's wise bestowment. I've no cause for worry or for fear. He whose heart is kind beyond all measure gives unto each day what he deems best.
Riches in Jesus, He giveth strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear.
He whose heart is kind beyond all measure gives unto each day what he deems best.
Our peace, who has broken down every wall. He is our peace. He is our peace. He is our peace, who has broken down.
great. Go ahead, be seated. Welcome. For all that have come, welcome for those that are online. Thank you for joining us, and thank you. Some of you have traveled a long ways to get here, and we sincerely appreciate that. Thank you. And today we're gathered for a particular reason, and that is to celebrate the life of my dad, but even more so, to celebrate the goodness of God and to give glory to him. And so it's a blessing to be able to be here and to remember Dad. And so I would like to do some scripture here. I have the Bible right here. That was one of the things that was very important in Dad's life, was the Bible. And so I want to focus on the verse that is on the obituary. It says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." And so I would like us to spend a little bit of time thinking about what that actually means. And those were the words that Dad often shared in the last while, was these words. And so that was close to his heart. And I would like to read a letter that my dad wrote to his parents in 1979, to his mom and stepfather in Mexico. He wrote that from here. Yesterday we went through some of the stuff, and I found the treasure there of this letter. I didn't know it was there. So I'd like to read that, but before I do that, I'd also like to mention a little bit. My dad was born in Manitoba and moved to Mexico around 19. And then, in Mexico, he was not living for Jesus. He was 25 or 24 years old when he made his commitment to follow Jesus. And I think he sometimes said he has never looked back. And so so this story is from, this is what he writes, is from 79. See if I can read that. "Dearly beloved parents, I have been thinking of writing to you for a long time, but never came to it. Sorry about that. We'll try and write now. First, wishing you both health and strength from above, where all our help comes, which I feel is so wonderful to think of. But how often do we think of the Lord as the one who gives us all the strength in all situations? Especially when we're healthy and feel like working, then I forget myself so often. But when I do think of what the Lord has done for me, that he died on the cross of Calvary for me, and that he's preparing a place in heaven for me, I feel I am unworthy of this, yet he gives me strength from day to day to improve myself, for he is so long-suffering and so patient with us. And if God should deal with me for what I am, I feel there would be no hope for me. But knowing my Lord for what he is and does for me, I can just say thank you, Jesus, for being so very good to me." "Yes, and then thinking of my dear parents who have prayed for me and have shown me the way to Jesus, I am so thankful for it. If it wasn't for your prayers, I very likely would still be lost. So thank you for your prayers and showing me such a wonderful Savior." So that was my dad. And so he expressed that for him to die is gain, and how can that be? So if we look at who wrote those verses in the Bible, who said that? And it was none other than the Apostle Paul. He's the one that wrote that down. And who was the Apostle Paul? How did he see himself? He saw himself as the worst of sinners. He at one point persecuted the church. He was part of putting people to death for following Jesus. So he was fighting against Jesus. That's Paul. And now he says it this way, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. How can that change happen? That is so such a big change. And so at first, obviously, Paul was against Jesus, and now he wants to be with Jesus. And if he lives, he wants to be with Jesus the whole time. He wants to live for Jesus, and when he dies, he wants to be with him all the time. And it says that, Paul also says, for me to leave this body is to be present with the Lord. And so he had a longing. He wanted to go. He had a desire to be with Jesus, which he said was much better. But how is this possible? When we think of heaven, we think of heaven being an absolutely perfect place. There's no evil there. There's nothing wrong there. And how can anybody get there? How is it possible? How could Paul, for what he had done, how could that ever be reconciled? And so, let me give you an example here. Some years back, I broke the law, and I got a ticket in the mail. And so there was an amount on the ticket that I needed to pay. And thankfully, I was able to pay that. And when I paid the ticket, the law never came after me. That was done. That was complete. And I don't think they ever asked whether I got the money from anybody else or how I managed to pay it, but they were satisfied because I had paid the full amount, I paid it in Canadian dollars, it was all good. Now, thinking back, I never thought of asking them, what if I would be very nice for a while, I would do at least 10 good things, or I would, yeah, promise to be very nice if they could just sort of erase that. And I never thought of it doing that. And my guess is that wouldn't have counted. They needed it in Canadian cash. That's the only way I could have settled that. So here's Paul with his big debt, what he did against Jesus' people. And now towards the end of his life, he's talking like this: to live is Christ and to die is gain. And then if we look at the other verses there in Jude, it says, to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Savior be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Do we see what's happening here? Paul the sinner was presented faultless, as having no fault at all, from being very seriously guilty to having no faults. And how was that possible? And so when forgiveness happens, somebody has paid it. Then the debt is covered and it's over. And so what I read here is that he will present us faultless in his presence. Jesus, the Son of God, he came. And that's what he says in John 14. He says, he says that if we believe in God, we should believe in him. And he says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. So guess who's talking here? This is Jesus, the one that came from the Father, and he's talking to us. And if anybody knows how it is, that would be him. So he says, if it was different, he would have told us so. So he came and told us exactly where things are at. This is how it stands. Then he continues on to say, no one comes to the Father except through me. So that seems clear enough. And so for Paul to be forgiven, it obviously had to come through Jesus, through what he did. And That takes me to that verse in John 1:9. It's very familiar. It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Wow. What's our part? It's the first part. To confess our sin, it's to admit that the wrong that I do, I did that against Jesus. I did that against God. So that's my part, to come to him and say, yes, I did this. And then the next part, he's faithful and just. Sometimes thought of that. How is justice done here? He's faithful and just to forgive. And I get that beautiful picture there that we have. He will present us faultless. So the picture I get is that Jesus is going to present us to God the Father. And when we stand before him, he's going to say, this person is faultless. It's all covered. And Jesus paid the full expense at his own cost. He paid that. And he does it with joy. Well, from what I read here, it's a joy to Jesus to do that. And for my dad, he had faults. And like I said, he only started living for the Lord when he was about 25 years old. And so he had sins in his life. And even as he continued on, he had faults. Like I do, and like we all do. But how is it possible, presented faultless? I could just picture Dad going home, and here he's presented with no faults, just completely free. And I believe that in heaven, the currency of good works won't do anything. Wouldn't pay my speeding ticket, it would do nothing. When we stand before God, the only payment that will do anything is what Jesus himself has done. And he wants to present us there, faultless. And when Jesus says to God, hey, this person is faultless, he's forgiven. God is just and he forgives and cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Can you imagine how clean that is when he's done? Up in heaven, there is absolutely no sin. There's no devil there. We can just imagine how beautiful. How beautiful. And who else but Jesus would you like to spend all eternity with? Like, what could be better? What could be imagined that would be better than that? And so, to me, that makes sense that for me to live as Christ and to die is gain. So my Father gained. It was a gain. It's a loss for us. We will miss him. We appreciate him a lot. But really, we're talking about again, we're talking about celebration. We're talking about a very bright future, and it's beautiful. And so the thing that the Bible clearly tells us, that we will all appear before God. That's a given. We will all appear before him, and we want to be of those that Jesus will say, this person is forgiven. He's free. He doesn't have any fault at all. We want to be of that. And we look forward. And that Jesus gives us that opportunity. So we keep on going here. And we're looking forward to what's ahead. But to be honest, we are in the devil's territory. We are in enemy territory right now, and we better be alert. And we're called to be faithful. It says he's able to keep us from falling, and that's what we're counting on as we continue on. And for my dad to be able to journey his whole life and to take time to be in God's word and to keep that fresh, his faith in his mind. So let me pray with us here as we're gathered here. Let's pray. Our great God in heaven, we give you honor and glory. We praise you that you make it possible for us what is impossible for ourselves, but you make it possible that we can look forward to being with you, Jesus, in heaven, that perfect place. And we can leave this place. We don't have to stay here forever, but we can leave this place and move on to be with you. And I thank you, give you the glory, Father, for the work that you did in my dad's life, how you brought him to yourself. You called him and he responded and said yes. Thank you so much, Lord, and thank you that you've given him to be with us all these years and the blessing that he has been. We give you praise and thanks, Lord. And even as we're gathered here, may you be with each one of us and guide us by your Spirit. And we want to honor you through this gathering here today. Amen. All right, we'll do some singing. And then after that, we'll ask Pastor Eric here to share the word with us. Pastor Eric was such a good friend of Dad's. Eric often came to visit him, and Dad appreciated it so much. So let's go ahead and do some singing.
Yes, good afternoon. My name is Henry Reimer, and I'm indebted to this man with gratitude for giving me the permission to marry his beautiful daughter, Sarah. And I often get picked by the family to stand up here and lead music, so it's a privilege. I really don't mind it. So we'll do two songs, and the words should pop up here, and I'll do it out of a Christian hymnal, which we don't have in our books here. So, other than that, it'd be not 2:21. Oh, that's right. I do need help. Grace greater than our sins, 3:21.
Slow.
How beautiful heaven must be.
Thank you, Henry, for leading us in song. Thank you for participating. That was good for my soul to hear that. Thank you. To the Plett family, I want to extend my condolences. And on behalf of the Marina Church, I want to say that you have been in our prayers. And we pray that God will give you comfort and peace today and in the coming weeks. And we also grieve with you. Many of us are here this afternoon because Joas made an impact on our life. And so we're not just supporting you, we are also grieving with you because he was a man that impacted him. He was a man that we greatly appreciated. One of my memories of Joas is how when Jen and I first moved here, and we knew very, very few people. Joas and Matilda was kind of One of the things that they did was just often they'd come find me in the church lobby before church or after church and thank you for your ministry and how is it going and are you feeling at home here? It was very important to your mom and dad that these strangers named Eric and Jen felt at home here. And we just very much appreciated that connection that I had with them. Another good memory is one winter we did Bible studies here. And Joas and I and Mr. Henry Friesen, we took turns leading a Bible study through the book of 1 Corinthians. And I thought every minister in their 30s at some point should lead a Bible study with men beside Joas, like men like Joas and Henry Friesen. That was good for me. And it was a rich, rich experience. In those times, in those Bible study times, I got to see how Joas loved God, and I got to see how Joas loved the Word, and how his church family was important to him. And so today, when Delmer has been teaching from the Word, and as I also want to teach from the Word, I think it's important that we realize that this isn't something that's we're kind of just tossing into the funeral because we have to. We're talking about this Joseph's Savior, Jesus Christ, and it just makes completely sense to talk about Jesus and how Jesus changed Joseph's life and how Jesus offers that transformation for all of us. I also want to expand a little bit on this verse from Philippians that Delmer introduced, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. The verses surrounding that verse are interesting to me. The thing that caught my attention this week is that Paul often says, thou shalt live like this. Or he'll say, "Thou, this is what you should believe. You're a Christian, this is what you believe. You're a Christian, this is how you live. But in this passage, Paul actually shares his story. It's actually autobiographical, that's not quite the right way to say it. It was an autobiography. He was saying, these are my experiences, these are my feelings, this is how I'm understanding it. So let's look a little bit what of the things that Paul said. I don't think Paul's really teaching here now. I think he's sharing with the young Christians in Philippi, this is my heart. Paul explained that he had been imprisoned because he had preached Jesus. But he knew that a person could be joyful in all circumstances. So in verse 18, he said, I will continue to rejoice. Notice he's not saying thou shalt be joyful. He's not saying if you're a good Christian, you will be joyful. He's simply saying, I will rejoice. I will rejoice. I am imprisoned, but it's given me chances to talk about Jesus. It's given me chances to encourage people in their faith. And so I will have joy. I will rejoice. And then Paul keeps sharing about his experiences, his hopes, and how he's benefiting from people's prayers. And then in verse 21, he penned what I think was probably Joseph's favorite verse. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. Well, what did Paul mean when he said to live is Christ? I think that simply means that Paul's life revolved around Jesus Christ. I think it means that for Paul, Jesus Christ was his everything. Everything else was second place. Wealth, safety, security, leisurely times, fame, reputation, power, all of this was a distant second place to Jesus. And when we think of the life that Paul lived, it's interesting because before he knew Jesus, he'd achieved lots in the eyes of the religious establishment. You kind of, when you read about who Paul was in the New Testament, you realize this man was going somewheres. He knew the law. He was connected. He had the right family tree. This man was going to go somewhere. He was zealous. He was going to be somewhere in the Jewish religious establishment. fame, reputation, power, influence, that was going to be his. But then on his way to Damascus, he met Jesus, and everything changed. Everything was different for Paul. All that power, that reputation, that fame, probably wealth would have eventually come with it. All of that was nothing because he knew who Jesus was. He had seen Jesus, and he couldn't go back. He wasn't going to go back. Jesus was first place. Everything else was a distant second. And so I think that's what Paul meant when he said to live is Christ. He was saying, Jesus is my everything. Everything else is second. Jesus is everything. And then he said, to die is gain. Well, Paul had so much joy, and he was filled with so much purpose. We know that there's no sort of suicidal thoughts here in Paul. What did he mean when he said, to die is gain? Paul loved his life on earth, and he loved serving Jesus here, but he also knew that death meant heaven, and he knew that earth had nothing compared to heaven. I look at it like this. Think about the last time you had a vacation. Think about your last vacation. You saw some nice sights. You did some things that you had never done before. Maybe you visited some family or some old friends that you were really wanting to see. Life was kind of a slower pace. You ate some really nice food. It was nice. It was a nice vacation. But if you're like most people, when you came home, you said, "This is nice. I miss my bed. I miss my home. I miss my friends and my neighbors. This is good. Vacationing, traveling is nice, but it's good to be home now." Paul knew that as people on earth here, we're travelers. He knew that we're travelers here, and life is good on earth, and there's nothing wrong with enjoying your life on earth. There's nothing wrong with enjoying time with the people that you have. It's good to enjoy your work. These are all good things. But Paul knew on earth, as humans, we're travelers. Paul knew that our best day on earth is nothing compared to a routine day in heaven. We were made to experience that abundance and perfection that we can only have in heaven while in the presence of God. The writer of Hebrews called heaven a better country. Hebrews 11 says that people of faith know that they are strangers and foreigners and travelers here on earth. He knows that we have a different citizenship. People of faith know that heaven is their real home. Hebrews 11 says that in the past, people of faith were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Life on earth is good, but the writer of Hebrews says, and Jules would agree, there's a better country. There's a better country than this. And that is why the Apostle Paul could so confidently say, to die is gain. And this is why Paul was torn between his two desires. Getting back to Philippians chapter 1, verse 22. It says, if I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. So in other words, life on earth meant that with his deeds and with his words, he could bless people. He could enrich their lives. And he enjoyed doing that. He says, yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. On the one hand, he was ready to die, and he was eagerly anticipating being with Jesus forever. He was eagerly anticipating that better country. On the one hand, he was anticipating that, but on the other hand, he wanted to stay on earth, and he wanted to bless these young Christians. He wanted to help them grow, and he wanted to see them grow. And then there's these last two verses from this passage. This is at verse 25. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. Paul wanted these young Christians in Philippi to grow. And he saw their when these young Christians will grow, their boasting in Jesus Christ will increase. Growth in Jesus means more boasting in Christ. Paul told the Philippians he wanted their boasting in Christ Jesus to increase. One thing that Paul made abundantly clear in his letters to Christians is that Christians don't boast about themselves, they boast about Christ. To the Ephesian church, he wrote, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." People are saved by grace through faith. Faith is the channel through which grace flows into our lives. When a person is humble enough to say, "Jesus, I am not good enough. I am not good enough to be your friend. I am not good enough to be with you in heaven one day. I need you, Jesus, to come into my life and make me good. I need you." When we put our faith in Jesus like that, then Jesus lets the floodgates open and just pours grace into our lives. And we become a new person. At that point, we become his children. We are saved from sin, and at that point, we are bound for heaven. One of the results of being a new person is that good deeds flow from us. And it's important to notice the order here. It's important to see the order of how things happen here. We become a new person, and then the good, and we are bound for heaven, and then the good deeds flow. We can't somehow muster up enough good deeds to get ourselves saved. Paul knew that. As I read before, it is by grace you have been saved through faith, not by works. The works come because the person has become a new person. Just like Paul experienced Jesus on the Damascus Road, and he would never be the same, when we experience Jesus, then the good works flow. This is why I believe the Bible teaches that heaven is not like a paycheck that an employer gives to a deserving employee. I think the Bible teaches that heaven is not like a paycheck that an employer gives to a deserving employee. I think if anything, heaven is more like a birthday gift that parents give to a three-year-old child just because they love their little boy or their little girl. It is a gift that God gives us, and it's more just like that three-year-old. They don't deserve that bicycle from mom and dad. We don't deserve heaven. But God, as a father who just loves to give good gifts to people, he offers heaven to all of us. Jesus said, "Anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." So to every single person, Jesus holds out a gift and says, "Here is a gift. Here is a gift. It's for you." When we think about who Joas was, we think of someone who had a friendship with Jesus. We think of a good family man. We think of a good neighbor. We think of a faithful church member. But Joas knew he wasn't on his way to heaven because of his works. He knew he was on his way to heaven because of God's grace through faith. Because of this amazing grace, because this incredible love had transformed Paul's life. Because of the amazing grace of God, Paul's model had become Joas's model. "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Let's bow our heads and pray. Our good God, we thank you for your incredible love. We thank you that while we were still sinners, you died for us. We admit that heaven is a paycheck that we could never earn. We admit that heaven is like a gift that mom and dad give to their little children. And so we come to you with humility. We come to you wanting your love, wanting your grace, wanting a relationship with you. On this day, we thank you for Joas. We thank you for the man he was. We thank you for how, with his words and with his deeds, he pointed people to Jesus Christ. May we be people like that. On this day, we pray for comfort. We pray for peace for the Plett family. May you wrap your arms of love around them. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
The obituary of Joas de Plett. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Philippians 1, verse 21. Joas de Plett of Arbroath, Manitoba, father, grandfather, and great-grandfather, passed away peacefully at the home of his son in Selkirk with family by his side and family joining over video call on March 20, 2024. At the age of 92 years and 10 months. He was predeceased by his wife of 65 years, Matilda, his parents, John R. and Sarah Plett, stepfather, Jacob Ukernelson, one grandson, Kenneth Plett, one daughter-in-law, Regina Plett, one great-grandson, Eli Craker, six brothers and three sisters. Dad was born on May 14, 1931, near Bloemenort, the fifth of nine children. Dad went to public schools nearby and completed eighth grade. When he was 11, his dad passed away suddenly. The loss had a formative impact on his life, particularly with managing finances. The saying that he adopted is, if you don't need it, don't spend money on it. He had to learn to be especially careful, I think, because there were tough times. His mom remarried Jacob Ukernelson, a widower with two children, 5 years later, bringing lots of change to the family. When Dad was 18, he moved with the family to Crown Colony, Mexico. In 1952, Dad returned to Manitoba for almost a year, where he worked and joined a bush hockey league. Playing hockey remained a significant part of his life until the age of 60, although his love for the game continued much longer. In 1953, Dad and his brothers built a mechanic garage in Mexico to fix cars and hosted wrestling matches for the young men, where Dad proved his strength again and again as reigning champion. His young adult life was filled with worldly living, only attending church to please his mom. However, when he noticed Matilda Kernelson, he realized his life would need to change if he wanted a future with her. On January 1st, 1956, he gave his life over to his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He was baptized in the Klein Gemeinde Church, March of 1956, upon confession of his faith. The next month, on April 29th, he married his sweetheart, and they started a family. Dad farmed in Mexico, but found the dry land made it very challenging to successfully grow crops. In 1964, Dad and Mom packed up their four children and moved to Morwena, Manitoba. They bought a farm that fall, and Dad worked hard to provide for his growing family. He started with turkeys, but progressed to farming, laying hens, along with grain and cattle. Family was important to Dad. He ensured that his nine children attended private school. Each morning, he faithfully led family devotions, which often included singing. His personal relationship with God was evident, and Dad took his children to church on a weekly basis. Although he worked hard, he also valued time spent as a family, enjoying little trips to Riding Mountain National Park every summer. As the family grew, these trips became less frequent and included in-laws and grandchildren. Dad appreciated his family, and Christmas family gatherings always included sharing from each family member and singing. Dad was a man of integrity, known in the community for his honesty, but in the church, both in the church and in farming. His bookkeeping was very detailed, and he chose to embrace technology as it was introduced. He will be lovingly remembered by his 9 children and spouses, Leanna, Gilbert, Gorette of Steinbeck, Delmer, Janice of Arburg, Ernie of Selkirk, Reynold and Janice of Arburg, Sarah and Henry Reimer of Arburg, Milton and Valerie of Arburg, Violet and Lyndon Reimer of Arburg, Myrna and Marlon Huber of Brownfield, Alberta, and Elner and Abe Neufeld of Seminole.
All right, we'll do our tributes here, and I'll let my youngest sister Ellie start us off here.
I have been so blessed with the dad that God gave me. I'm thankful for the spiritual leader that he was at home and the good example he set. Dad had such a generous and selfless character, I can't remember ever hearing him complain. His relationship with God was important to him, and his desire was that everyone in the family would also choose to follow God. Most mornings, he would lead family devotions at the breakfast table. Some mornings, when I got up early enough, I would see him sitting at the dining room table reading his Bible. It wasn't a question whether or not we went to church on Sunday. That's just what we did, and he didn't like to be late. When I was growing up, I remember going along with Dad to the egg truck when he brought eggs to the city. Sometimes, pretending to reach for the gear lever, he would squeeze and tickle my knee instead. While in the city, he would often stop at McDonald's for cheeseburgers, knowing that's what I liked. Having lived in Texas for the past 20-plus years, I haven't had as many opportunities to spend time with Dad recently, but I do have some precious memories with Dad. One of them is going to Banff with him in October 2022 when I went to visit him in Alberta while he was staying at Marlon and Myrna's. He was excited about going to Banff and quite enjoyed it, even going on the gondola lift. Last year, I came to Manitoba for Easter with 2 of my sons. On the day we were planning to leave to go home, it was snowing and the roads were not in good driving condition. Dad called me to tell me about the weather. I so appreciated his concern for me. What made that extra special was because he would rarely call me. Even though he might not have said it often, I knew he loved me and was praying for me. After Mom passed, Dad was often lonely and longed to go to heaven. Although we will miss Dad, I'm thankful he got his wish to go to his heavenly home. Thank you to my siblings and other family members who took such good care of Dad after Mom passed. A special thanks to Ernie for taking Dad into your home to live with you.
For those of you that don't know me, I'm Myrna, the second youngest. Tribute to my dad. My precious dad, where do I begin in paying tribute to a man that I greatly respected and admired? One of my earliest memories was on a family trip during a thunderstorm, stopping beside the road for a much-needed bathroom break. I was scared of the lightning and didn't want to get out of the vehicle. So I said, dot flits, de kvelding houta pa. Somehow I thought if I wore my dad's cap, I would be protected from the lightning. Another example of Dad as my protector was when we had a drunk man show up at our door in the middle of the night. I was ready to get in there and help, but instead I just caused more problems as he began to accuse my dad of stealing his wife and kids. Thankfully, I got behind the locked door just in the nick of time. My dad was so calm and handled him with such wisdom, keeping his wits about him. In the aftermath, I took comfort in being near my dad. He was my protector and my hero. On a lighter note, he was also my hockey hero. I loved to watch him play, shouting, "Go, Dad!" I was so proud of him, and the others in the stands would join me shouting, "Go, Dad!" He played hockey until he was 60 years old and enjoyed taking us to Jets games and listening to their games on the radio. Farming with my dad created a lot of precious memories. When I was younger, I would ride on the roof of the combine, and during spraying season, I would love to flag for the sprayer operator. We were safety first back in the day. I was amazed at the confidence and trust Dad had in letting me drive equipment. A favorite of mine was hauling grain, even though the brakes on the grain truck often didn't work. One evening, after already hauling a few loads of grain into town, I went back to the field and discovered that my dad had caught his finger in the combine pulley. No one else was around, and the only vehicle available was the grain truck. I grabbed some rags to wrap his hand in, and off we went, attempts fencing, pounding the post on all fencing, pounding the post on all the sides of the staple, and every once in a while even hitting the staple. One of the things I really admired about Dad was the example he set as a business person. I think about it often in our own family farm and business. He trusted God to provide, and I don't ever remember seeing him stressed even once. I'm sure he must have been, but I never saw it. He gave the farm over to God and was a good steward, paying attention to small details. Some examples of this was his bookkeeping skills, strict schedule, and management of the chicken barn. Each day, we would mark down exactly how many eggs we gathered, and he paid us accordingly, which was usually around 5,000 eggs a day. Dad's faithfulness and relationship, well, per person if there was two of us, Dad's faithfulness and relationship with God was an inspiration to me. Every morning at 7 o'clock, I could count on Dad sitting at the end of the table with his Bible open. He was optimistic, wise, humble, and unselfish in so many ways, being careful not to run down other people. I remember when I asked for his help in making a life-changing decision, should I go back to Texas and teach or move to Alberta where there was no job waiting for me? His insightful response was, it seems you feel pressured to go to Texas, but you feel called to go to Alberta. That was all the encouragement that I needed to follow God's calling, and Alberta has been my home ever since. It was incredibly special to go full circle and have Dad spend hours riding with me in the combine on his recent trips to Alberta. I am so grateful for Dad, my hero, my protector, advisor, and great example. I would not be the same person without the man I'm proud to call my dad.
I have many memories too I could share. And when I try to recall a few things, I'm sure there's many more that will come in the days to come. Very grateful for my dad and the security that he gave to us as children. I never once ever even thought that he would ever leave Mom. It never even crossed my mind. I don't think it ever crossed his mind either. And just that security is worth a lot, a lot. About 70 years ago, not quite, he gave his heart to Jesus Christ. He put his faith in the Lord and served him till his death. And about 70 years ago, he married his sweetheart. About 30 years ago, his sweetheart went through a dark valley. She was depressed. It was like she was in a dark tunnel with no light at the end. And that went on for quite a while. I don't know how long. Dad remained faithful. And looking back, I'm so thankful. And I don't think he ever had anything else in mind but to be faithful. He was true to his vow. He was true to his God. And I too want to be true to my God.
I'm Sarah, if you hadn't known. The middle child, a tribute to my strong, generous, dedicated dad. Where do I begin to express my appreciation for such a wonderful dad? God blessed me with a dad who was honest and upright in his dealings with others. He was a dedicated family man and a good role model to us in many ways. Let me begin from when I entered his life. Thanks, Dad, for choosing to make the move to Manitoba from Mexico in 1964, the year I was born in Arbroath. This made it possible for all of us children to get an English education in our private school in Morwena. I remember how you faithfully paid the tuition fees. Thanks, Dad, for being willing to take risks, sometimes standing on your own. I admired you for playing hockey, even though you were alone from your peers, joining the younger men in the Morwena Missiles team, playing until you were 60 years old. You also had an interest in watching hockey. Years ago, you took some of us kids to a Jets game after supper at Chi-Chi's in Winnipeg. That remains a precious memory for me. Dad's love for hockey even brought him and Mom out to Hamiota to watch Trevor play hockey at his first provincials, staying overnight, which was super special. Thanks, Dad, for your dedication to our family. Not only did you work hard to pay the bills, but you also took time to get away and spend a week at the lake with us every summer. Thanks for teaching me good work ethics. Gathering eggs every day after school was part of this. I remember Monday mornings when we had to get up super early to gather eggs before school because we hadn't done it on Sunday. I would come down the stairs and find you sitting at the table with the Bible open, having your devotions. Dad, you had an authentic faith in God that contributed to the honesty, generosity, kindness, and resilience I saw in you. Thanks, Dad, for going to computer school with me when this new technology was introduced in Morwena. You were willing to embrace the new ways of tackling bookkeeping, and we learned together. We have spent many hours doing bookkeeping for the farm. It was such an honor for me to have Dad hand over the books when it was too much for him to do anymore. Right up to our last visit with Dad, he wanted to make sure that I would hand in my hours to him and get paid for doing his book work, which wasn't really very much anymore, but he trusted me with that, so I felt really honored. Thanks, Dad, for selling the New Valley Farm to us at a reasonable price. We have made this house our home since 1993, and we are very grateful to you for making this possible. Dad, I am proud of your strength, both physically and spiritually, all through the years. You are my hero in so many ways. In the last 4 years, we saw you pull through four times when we thought we were losing you. You had your first heart attack February 20, 2020, and another one in August of the same year. Last March, you had some heart-related episode as well, and then last July, another incident that made us contemplate palliative care. You recovered amazingly well again. So when I heard you had a bad cold on March 20, I didn't expect you to leave us. It came as a complete shock for me. At the same time, I'm very happy for you to be in your heavenly home now. All the trips I made to Selkirk in the last year to see you, Dad, were worth it. I never knew when my last visit would be, which turned out to be March 15, when Henry and I brought you supper. I had cooked potato soup, like Mom used to make, at least her sister did. It was her recipe. And you had more than one helping. You loved it. We said our goodbyes after you were tucked into bed for the night, not knowing this would be our last time. Oh, Dad. I am so glad for the times we celebrated with you, including the supper we had on February 9th this year as we remembered Mom on the second anniversary of her death. I will miss my calls to you and how you answered with, "Hello, Sarah." When I asked how you were doing, you'd often say much the same or not so good, but you would usually also ask me about Henry. Dad, no more lonely times or boredom for you. You have been released to a life of bliss beyond what we can imagine. Waiting to see you in our forever home. Love you, Dad. Your daughter, Sarah.
Yes, I have many, many memories of Dad. I just have a short little list here. I could make way more and miss a lot, but to my dear dad, whom I love so much. I will miss you greatly. The memories of a dad are numerous. Thinking of all the times we went to Winnipeg together and the talks we had about life we had, even in my rebellious years. Dad, you still love me. Playing hockey with him together made me feel more respected by other people just because he was oldest, and I appreciated that. And crokinole, we spent many hours playing crokinole. Now and then I could win him, but not very often, but I did win him now and then. And working in the fields together, Dad, you were so generous and caring in times of our need. The faith you showed me by having daily devotions with family and singing songs together. When I would go to visit you, you cared about me and enjoyed hearing my stories of where I had been while trucking. Dad, you were always ready and willing to give good advice, full of wisdom and guidance. I am thankful to God was so gracious that you didn't need to suffer. I am eagerly looking forward to the day where I meet you and Mom and Kenneth and other loved ones, and to see Jesus face to face. And I am thankful that he saved me from your son, Ray.
I'm Ernie. A few things I want to say about my dad. It was such a great privilege to have him in my home for just over a year, this past year. And it was very interesting to get to know myself. It's like, okay, that's why. That's why I do what I do. That's why I think the way I think, et cetera, et cetera. It was quite interesting, but a tremendous blessing. I'm so grateful for the opportunity, even though he often would say, well, you know, this isn't home, and I don't want to be in your way. You know, I'm stopping your life now because now you got to look after me, and someday I'll get better. I'll go to the doctor, and he'll give me the pill, and I'll be better, and I'll be out of here, you know. I think that was the last month yet that he was still hoping he'd be getting better. He was forever the optimist, you know. He's going to get better, and then he'll be back on his own. He wasn't quite sure what he's going to do when he gets back on his own again, but that was Dad. And I think that's a reflection of his optimism through the years. I know Mom would comment sometimes, it's like she would already a long time ago have given up. But Dad, he was still optimistic and going on. And I know there's some very, very hard times in the family, and Dad just had to make a decision, like, will I let these things get me down and drag me down into the mire and sadness and just despair? And it's like, well, that's not going to help my family. That's not going to help the situation. And so he found strength in the Lord, much like King David did in his tough times, and sought the Lord and continued to lead his family. And I think it bears repeating, his daily Bible reading. And the one thing that he often did with his Bible reading was to pick one verse for that day to take with him, to memorize, or maybe not memorize, but take with him. He was an encouraging dad. I remember when I was maybe 8 or 9 years old, we had done some Bible memory, and he just commented that I was good at memorizing or something. And that was something that went with me and encouraged me through the years to memorize the scriptures. And I dare say, had it not been for that encouragement, I would not have memorized near the amount of scripture. But just that word of encouragement. And Dad was encouraging, even now in the ministry. When he was there this last year, he was interested in my life, praying for people or how people were doing. And so not having a wife to share with, oftentimes I would share things with him. And he would pray for those particular needs that I was facing in church life or in the church family even. And so, church family, Grace Life, you've been blessed by my dad's prayers. And thank you so much for being there for him as well and the friendship that you offered him. A particularly touching event was the last Sunday when Dad was still with me, with us. March 17th, I wasn't feeling well. I had a cold, and so I had stayed home. Instead of staying in my bed in the living room like I normally did, I had gone to my bedroom to sleep there and to rest. And I'm laying in my bed resting and recovering, and I hear this walker coming down the hall. And it keeps coming, keeps coming, keeps coming. And finally, he's by my door. He turns into the door and says, "Ernie, how are you doing?" Okay. That was Dad. He did at least twice that day. He checked up on me. Dad had a very caring heart, a tender heart. And then later in the evening, that still wasn't good enough. He finally called my daughter, Sherry, and said, "You know, your dad's not feeling too well. Maybe you could find a pill for him or something. He could feel better." I mean, he had already told me earlier during this time I had a cold, I should just call the doctor. Sure, he could give me a pill and I'd feel better. So anyway, Dad's kindness, Dad's care. And that was who Dad was. I know sometimes I felt a little bit he was very sensitive to pain, it seemed like. He had never suffered much pain in his life. And so even if you put the lotion on his back, if you didn't warm that up enough, put on his back, really, really howls like that. It's not that bad. I know it's a little cold, but it's not painful for sure. Anyways, some of the joys of looking after my dad, it was such a privilege, such a privilege. I just thank God for giving me that privilege to pour into his life. And for him, you know, here we are, two widowers and hanging out together, comforting each other in the loss of our wives. And so, yes, Dad, I will miss you immensely. My house will be very empty without you. Even Monday, before you passed away, I'm working in my room, and I hear this clatter in the other room, and it's like, what's going on? It didn't sound like Dad had fallen, but obviously he was up to something. And there I get into the living room, and there he's standing by the piano, and he's moving stuff around on top of the piano. Because he said at nighttime, he couldn't see part of the clock. 2, 3, and 4 were kind of, the light was shining on it. So he was moving the clock over so that he'd be able to see it at nighttime. It's very important for him to see the clock and to wear his watch every night, even if his arm got sore. He'd put it on the other arm, but the watch had to be there. So he's moving stuff over. And in the process, all these songbooks, which are now kind of even worse for wear, fell to the floor. And I guess that's what I heard. So as I was helping him kind of get the stuff moved over so he could have it where he wanted, and I was putting this one card that he had gotten at one spot, and this, oh, no, that card goes over here. I said, okay. I'm sure he laid there for a while and mapped it all out before he got up. But it was just interesting that at that stage of life, he had that kind of initiative to get up and rearrange as he needed it done. Dad was a man of hospitality, and I'm sure Mom would say, yeah, there's many times I got a chance to cook. But he showed that hospitality in a number of ways. One that I found a little bit sometimes not the most welcoming was if there was any kind of a knock anywhere close to the door, it was, come in, come in. It's like, Dad, we're living in Selkirk. I don't know if I want everybody in that knocks at the door. But that was his response. I was a little naughty, I'll say I was. I was at the back door one time, knocked just for the fun of it. Yeah, come in, come in. So that was just his memory. It just reflects in being so hospitable and kind. In fact, one time we had the barber come over to give us haircuts, and she brought her two boys with her, and they were kind of hungry and stuff, and they had been promised a treat to go to McDonald's to get their fries afterwards, and Dad just couldn't get over it. It's like, Ernie, you should have given them supper to eat. Like, you should have given them something to eat. And it's like, Dad, I'm not much of a cook, you know. Sorry. And these guys are waiting for their treats. But that was one of the examples of hospitality, that he really wanted to be hospitable. And or if anybody else came over, make them some soup or something. Like, give them something to eat. That was Dad. He certainly did enjoy his food right till the end, pretty much. Maybe not the last day that he passed away, but he certainly did enjoy his food. It was a joy cooking for him. It was easy to cook for him because he was one that would eat well. Well, last the 20th Wednesday, no idea that would be the last day. I think a few days before, well, this might be a few more years yet. You know, yeah, he had gotten weaker, and I had to help him a bit more, and he'd walk from the kitchen to the living room, and he'd be panting by the time he got to his chair, but that was kind of par for the course, you know, it wasn't that much worse. But over the past month, I would say he had weakened some, and I think he got the cold that I had, perhaps, but I didn't think was that bad. He was at the breakfast table that morning, didn't eat that much, but he was at the breakfast table, and went back went back to his bed and rested and was at the supper table again that evening and didn't eat that much at that time. Well, kind of par for the course. I knew he had a bit of a cold. He went back to bed again and then I had our Bible reading like we normally did. And he was commenting as I was reading and asking who had written this and stuff like that. Again, and then I sang him a song, you know, "My God, I am determined forever thine to be." And he commented about that song. And that was his determination to always be the Lord. And another one that now, in hindsight, I think was more for me than for him, was just that phrase or that song, "He promised never to leave me alone, no, never alone." And so I sang that chorus, I thought for him, but I think more for me. But he commented on that as well. You know, sometimes it seems like the Lord has left you alone. And though he hasn't, but at times it seems that way. And now as I reflect on it, that is perhaps my song to take home, that the Lord will never leave me alone. My house is empty, but not really. The Lord is with me. So I thank God for that. So then as the evening wore on, home care came. And he was quite tired. In fact, so tired that the home care worker would stop for a little while to let him rest a bit. But again, kind of par for the course. I knew he had a bit of a cold. And then when she left, I gave him his night pills, got him ready for bed, gave him his Lantus, or his insulin as well. And then he didn't want to settle, it seemed. And he wasn't feeling too well. So I said, "Well, maybe I should give you a Tylenol pill to make you feel better." I said, "Oh, no, give me a Tylenol pill. It's going to kill me because it's going to wreck my liver." It's like, it's only the fourth one today. You could have ate. It's no issue. So finally, I took it, and a little bit after that, oh, man, that pill was bad for me. That pill didn't work. that wasn't good. And then he asked me, "How long can a person live without air?" I didn't think about it that much because he was still breathing, and I didn't comment, and then he mentioned twice, "I just can't get any air. I can't get any air." But he wasn't that distressed. When he, like a year ago, he had an episode, he was extremely distressed when he couldn't get air, when he filled it with fluid. And I said, "Dad, maybe you should just lay down, because you're going up and down, that's going to wear you out and you don't have much energy." And then he lay down and kind of was resting at that point. And eventually Sherry came over. I had called her, and "Thank you, Sherry, so much for your support during this last year. It was just a blessing." Sherry is a nurse and also has worked palliative, so she's very familiar with these kinds of things. And just a blessing. And when Sherry then came over, she realized that the end was very near and did call the ambulance. And they came a while later. There was nothing for them to do. We thought maybe some oxygen might make him feel more comfortable. But very thankfully that he was not in distress. And then his last words, probably best if Sherry said them, but, "Lord, please take me to heaven." That's the last he spoke. And his eyes kind of rolled back, and after that, it wasn't responsive. And within 25 minutes or so, he went to be with the Lord very peacefully. And Dad, I will cherish you, and I'll cherish this last year, and thank you for your support.
Yeah, so many precious memories. Go back a little bit when I was growing up there on the farm there with Dad, and things were obviously not going very well sometimes with farming, and so it was a tough go. But I was interested in working with steel and doing stuff, and we found enough steel to build a go-kart, and later on I had a chance to work on making a bale stoker that we never actually put into production, but he gave me that opportunity. And 1 year I even farmed with him, so I had to go and work at Vita Machine for a while to pay for that, but anyways, he was working with me, so that was interesting. But then also in the church, he was involved in so much different kinds of things. And when they moved here from Mexico, pretty soon he was involved in teaching VBS here locally. Still find that interesting. He was, whatever, in a sense, having a tough go, making things go. But no, VBS, he had time to do that.
And I believe he was the Beaver Creek Bible Camp board very much when the camp started. And he was quite faithful with that. He was served in different committees, and some of them I even served with him. And then he also took a trip to do some MDS at Rapid City, took a number of youth with him. And then when I wanted to go and work for a mission in Ontario, he seemed to be okay with that. And so happy to let me go and do that. And so I was there for over 3 years, so I missed some of the things that my siblings obviously know about. But I also got involved with doing some hockey with Dad, and that was definitely a joy. And we had that rink right at our house there, and so we had lots of fun, was lots of work, but it was good. And what really stands out to me is for Mom and Dad, they had a way of getting their cousins to come and board there. Not just cousins, they had Joe Golas there for a while, they had others that they, whatever, came and lived there with Mom and Dad through the years. And so there's a number of my cousins, whatever, that were had that privilege. And what a joy. And now in the latter years here now, I had opportunity to spend some time with Dad. He was at the House of Hope yet. Time to make breakfast for him, and so that was interesting. I was used to simple breakfast, but his always had to have cornflakes was one of them, and then he liked to have his eggs and toast and a bit of meat, a bit of garlic sausage, whatever. And it was interesting making breakfast for him while I would be getting ready. Well, I need a spoon yet. Oh, where's my coffee? I couldn't do it fast enough. So, but then we would get going and okay, so we would like to pray before we eat. And sometimes he was just eating already. He was just going on already. And so, yeah, but we had good times reading the daily bread there. And he would participate in that and be part of praying. And so, yeah, he had his challenging times there, but eventually it got to where he needed even more care. And what I appreciate from my dad is how the care of the people that took care of him, the medical people, he was so gracious with them. It seemed like they liked to take care of him. It's just what it felt like. I know at House of Hope, they really expressed their how much they appreciated Dad there. And and so now for quite a while, he needed constant care, evening and morning, and the nurse would sometimes come during the day. And so this man that was the best wrestler now was getting weak. I find it hard to walk very far without the walker or even with the walker. And so he was getting tired of being tired. It just seemed like things were kept going. And thanks to our health system, there was whatever, they were able to find the right medication to get the balance just right. He was diabetic, and so they was constantly, okay, what's his blood sugar today? And so we were constantly tracking all that, and it was seemed to be fairly manageable. And so I'm grateful that opportunity was there. I think he would not have been with us this long if it hadn't been for that. So, and even for in Selkirk to have that kind of a help there, that there were health people that came. Sure, they missed some days, but as a rule, they were there. But one of the good memories I had is to sit with Dad and to sing hymns together and we would do that in the evening before I'd leave. Went to see him many times there in Selkirk and just to, well, I enjoyed the songs myself, but when I would sing those songs, he would have such a hearty thank you for the song. He appreciated them so much. And one last thing, we got together there as a family at Christmas time, and so when we get together, we talk about different things, and we were just talking about what's 2024, what do we want to do in 2024? And so we went around the circle, and it was Dad's turn, and he said, in 2024, I'm going to go to heaven. So he got his wish.
My name is Liana Grett, and as my dad said at the end of our last phone chat, which was the Friday before his passing, he told the home care nurse, my daughter, my oldest daughter, very precious, There's so much to be said for dear precious dad, but let me point out a few things that I consider extra special. I feel so blessed that we were privileged to have had godly parents who were diligent in establishing and providing a stable, godly home for us. They taught us so many valuable things in life. One of those truly valuable things was them teaching us the scriptures, even at an early age. I considered my dad to be a man of integrity, determination, optimistic, and courageous. One of those courageous times in particular was in 1964, when we made our move to Canada. It was just days before Dad and Mom's 8th anniversary. Arriving in Manitoba on April 25th, 1964, our Uncle Eddie and Aunt Elizabeth, Mom's brother, offered my parents the back seat of their car to take us to Canada. We were 6 passengers for the back seat. Dad was 32 years old, Mom was 29, I was 7, Delmer 5, Ernie 3, and Reynold 2. It was a challenging time as my parents had no extra money to live on, as Dad put it, to begin a life in Manitoba. To add to the challenges, I was starting with the German measles and on our trip and was the carrier of the measles to my cousins. We started off with staying at Uncle Henry's and Uncle and Aunt Tina and Uncle Pete and Aunt Mary, alternatively, because before my parents were able to buy a farm with some financial help from Abram C.L. Penner, who was a kind, wise man and had the finances to help us out. My dad had a way of facing the challenges on our newly purchased farmstead, where stones were in abundance. So some of his older siblings would spend hours in the field picking stones by hand and loading them onto a trailer with Dad. I seldom had this opportunity because my mom needed my help inside. So I really enjoyed this opportunity, even if it was hard work. Another incident where my dad's character of grace and courage came through clearly was when our cattle got out of the fence and ended up in the neighbor's field. Our non-Mennonite neighbor was very distraught and upset. Dad had a kind way of making peace. When offering him a cup of coffee, etc., didn't work, Dad offered to pay for the expense. After the upset neighbor told him how much he thought Dad owed him, Dad came up with $125 that Dad was able to borrow from ACL Penner. After that, we were better neighbors with our friend, our neighbor, yeah, our better friends, I should say, with our neighbor. Dad and Mom had taught us to let go and let God, which they had also learned over the years through the trials and challenges we experienced many times where the Lord intervened for us as a family and kept us safe. Another saying which I reminded Dad about quite recently and he agreed with was, only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Now, in the later months of Dad's life, after he moved in with my brother Ernie and Dad's health was failing at times, I got into the habit of calling Dad weekly, generally on Friday mornings at 11:10. As my health wasn't too good, I wasn't able to visit Dad in person the way I would have liked to. I found phone chats with Dad to be a real blessing and encouragement. It was a real blessing to go down memory lane and reminisce about the past, as his memory was still so sharp most of the time. I'm gonna miss Dad. Also enjoy talking about spiritual things with Dad, reviewing the truths of the gospel, reading some scriptures, and singing hymns to him. It was an encouragement to see Dad's joy in talking about what Christ has done for us and about heaven and dying, etc. I recall one of those phone chats where I read some verses from John 14, which seemed to give Dad real joy. Let me share these precious verses with you. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I can go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I believe that my dad understood and believed the gospel, as found in 1 Corinthians 15:3-4, how that Christ died for our sins, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Also what John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. This is also what I believe, and thus look forward to meeting my dear dad and mom in heaven one day. Thanks be to the Lord Jesus Christ for his great gift of salvation. I so appreciate Dad's care and his loving, encouraging words to both Gilbert and me. As much as I love and miss my dear dad so deeply and would love to see him and talk to him again, I'm grateful for his sake that he's free from his sufferings and enjoying the glories of heaven where he so longed to go. As Dad said lately, The Lord knows the number of our days, but he hasn't told us what that number is. Until we meet again, dear Dad and Mom, we will go on in the strength of the Lord till he calls us home. Love you, Dad.
So the song that was on a lot of our minds as we thought about Dad was I Owe the Lord a Morning Song. That's a lot of us brought up how at 7 in the morning he would be there reading the scriptures, and this would be one of his favorite songs to sing together in the morning. I know it's not morning right now, but we want to sing that song. It just talks about God keeping him till he calls him home and also just directing his ways each day, and I just felt like it was an example of who my dad was.
Children.
Okay, we are here to read tributes from the grandkids. So my name is Galen. I'm Henry and Sarah's second son. And there'll be no particular order here, but we'll just start. This one's from Doug. I remember playing Touch You Last with Grandpa. He was very quick and almost impossible to beat. The only way was in the winter if he was only wearing socks and you ran into the snow. But even then, he would come out after you. I also loved going with him to Winnipeg with eggs or riding with him on farm equipment. Christmas time was always a favorite. You could go to Grandpa's place any time during the holidays to play games. And 7-Up and 7-Down was a favorite. Sabina says, I remember visiting Grandma and Grandpa's one day. Grandma and I were working in the kitchen and Grandpa was in the office working on the computer when he sneezed so loud that he frightened us. Grandma said one time he would sneeze and he would scare us out of the house, and by the time he would have realized, we would already be out by the road. I always think of Grandpa when I sneeze loud. He said it felt better. I also remember visiting Grandma and Grandpa was eating an avocado. He said the doctor told him they were good for him, but they really didn't taste like anything. Grandpa and ketchup went together. When he wasn't supposed to eat sugar anymore, he was just glad the doctor hadn't said he couldn't eat ketchup. I am thankful to have the memory of Grandpa having devotions with the family when he had family gatherings and campouts. Grandpa had a positive perspective in life and a good sense of humor. I know Grandpa has left a good inheritance for his children's children, the inheritance of a faith in God. I realize not all people have the blessing of Christian grandparents, and I am very thankful that I had grandparents that had faith and hope of eternal life, and that they passed it on to us, their grandchildren.
My name is Tricia, and I am Milton and Valerie's second child. From Kylan, Grandpa cared so much about what was going on in my life. He was eager to support Michaela and I as we were doing missions in Wyoming. His prayerful support meant so much. I am so grateful that Michaela got to meet him before he passed. From Sherry, favorite memories from when I was young included being on the farm. He always had time to let us do things with him on the farm, whether it was working in the chicken barn, riding the combine, or being in the shop with him. Trips to Winnipeg when hauling eggs always involved eating at restaurants, which was a real treat. He was always fun to talk to, and I recall asking him lots of questions, and he'd always have something to say. He was a very good grandpa. He cared about each of his family members, always excited for any new additions to the family. Seeing his thoughtful and caring side increase as he aged was very sweet, and I enjoyed being able to care for him.
This one's from Jeremiah. I am so grateful to God for blessing me with the most amazing grandpa. You were more than just a grandparent to me. You were full of love, kindness, and caring to your family. There are so many memories of us spending time together at your house, playing games with you and grandma, remains etched in my mind as some of the best times of my life. Even as I reminisce about our games of Crokinole, where you always emerged victorious, it's not the wins I remember most, but the joy of your company. Grandpa, I want to thank you for every moment you invested in me. Your unwavering commitment to raising me in a godly home has left an indelible mark on me. As I face the future without you, the holidays and family gatherings may never be the same without you. But I take comfort in knowing that the love of God you showed will be seen in your family and carried on. Thank you for being the best grandpa a grandchild could ever ask for. You will forever hold a special place in my heart. Until we meet again, rest peacefully, Grandpa. And this is from Janie. Memories I have with Grandpa is that he got me every time. When he started to bark like a dog, we played games together, and Grandpa had humor when he was playing certain games, and of course having coffee together. I will miss Grandpa, and a hug and telling him that I loved him.
Conroy says he enjoyed Grandpa's humor while playing Crokinole, and just playing it with him was a good memory. He also enjoyed the many visits he made to them at House of Hope. Grandpa allowing me to drive their vehicle was special to me. Shania says, my special moment I had with Grandpa was when we played Crokinole. He was really good at the game and I wasn't so good, but it was a great moment together. I love you and I will miss you, Grandpa. From Samuel, the many visits they made to our place in Alberta and how they would play Red Rover and Grandpa would chase and catch him. Another memorable moment was when a huge rock was stuck between the tractor tires and Grandpa had an idea. If he would wrap a chain around the rock and then tie the chain to the handlebar, close the door of the tractor, they could remove the rock. Unfortunately, the rock stayed and the handlebar bent, and Grandpa's remark was, "Now that wasn't a good idea after all, was it?" Grandpa, you were always ready to give good advice. Grandpa, you encouraged us to remain faithful to God right to the end.
This one is from Charity. I always enjoyed visiting Grandpa and Grandma. One day, when I was visiting Grandpa and Grandma, he was working in his office. He would often sneeze really loud, and one time he said he'd sneeze so loud, we'd all get scared and run out of the house, and we'd be by the road, and he would come to the door and wonder what the problem was. He sneezed very loud, he really did. And this is from Jaleesia, Krista Lee, Layton, Larissa, and Jaden. And it says, we weren't able to spend a lot of time with Grandpa because we lived in Alberta. We visited as often as we could. Grandpa and Grandma made a few trips out to Alberta over the years. Grandpa was also able to make a couple trips to Alberta after Grandma's passing. We enjoyed that time with Grandpa, some memorable times. We're having him visit during harvest season and ride in the combines and trucks. It was special to have him watch Layton and Larissa play various sports games. We also enjoyed hearing multiple stories of the adventures he had when he was younger. Grandpa was a very kind and gracious man of God, and he loved each of his grandkids very much. We will forever treasure the time we got to spend with him.
From Jonathan. I always look forward to coming to Grandpa and Grandma's house for the afternoon on my birthdays, having a snack and visiting. I was always happy for opportunity and privilege of doing lawn care and trimming hedges at Grandpa's house in the summers that they lived beside us, and in the winter being able to clear the snow from the driveway. From Jonathan and Rebecca and their children, we feel very blessed to have been able to buy the house that we live in from Grandpa. As we live life in the house, there are always little things that remind us of Grandpa and Grandma. In the summers, we thoroughly enjoy being able to enjoy the yard that they so carefully and beautifully put thought into, from cherry and apple trees to flowers and bushes that they thoughtfully planted, are a continual reminder of the dear grandparents. We appreciate this very much. It was also special to us that Grandpa in his last days would occasionally ask us how our children were doing, and specifically would ask about how Owen was growing, and enjoyed seeing pictures of him. From Judith. Some of my earliest memories of Grandpa are him reading me stories and the way he liked to imitate a dog bark to entertain us or to tease a dog. I also remember his big sneezes that were sometimes startling. When I was a little older, I can remember collecting small eggs in the barn and putting them into my pocket and Grandpa telling me this wasn't a good idea. I wasn't sure why, so he took the time to explain that the eggs were likely to break and make a mess inside my pocket. It was special when Trevor and I got to go along to Winnipeg together on an egg hauling trip once. After we had moved to the farm and my sisters and I took turns picking eggs, I can remember Grandpa stopping in sometimes to chat with Dad or gather eggs with us. Sometimes he would come by on his afternoon walk when he needed to take to help regulate his blood sugar and get eggs for Grandma. He liked to try to startle us as he came in. Another special memory I have after I got my driver's license was being able to go and pick up Grandpa from the field and have him ride with me in the pickup while we chatted about this and that. Grandma and Grandpa were both interested in my life and wanted to know that I was happy and fulfilled. It also thrilled their hearts to know that I had surrendered my life to the Lord and was walking with him.
This one's from Daniel. Grandpa was quite the crokinole player. I enjoyed the games we played together and enjoyed watching him play. I remember being amazed at some of the shots he would make. I remember thinking that there was no way he can make that shot, but to my surprise he did, and did again, and again. Grandpa always was also a caring man, and it always felt like he cared about us and cared what was going on in our lives. He was a man of wisdom too. There are many words of wisdom that he has spoken and that I have heard him speak. I will always remember his kindness, his strength, and his perseverance. He kept going even when things got hard. He demonstrated how to live as a man of faith and gave me an example to follow. I will always be grateful for the time we had with him, and I look forward to seeing him and Grandma someday again in heaven.
From Brianne. I'm going to miss Grandpa's firm handshake and hello each time I came over to visit him. I'm starting to realize now how incredible it is to have had a grandpa who cared about my life and showed interest in it, even if it wasn't something he could fully relate to, like my teaching job or my travel adventures. Also having a grandpa who was generous with his time and money. I knew any time we'd eat at a restaurant, Grandpa wouldn't allow me to pay. He showed his care in being steady and consistent in my life. It still feels very strange for me to use the past tense when talking about Grandpa because he's simply always been in my life. Some memories I have with Grandpa is road tripping to Alberta with him and Grandma and my mom when I was about 12 years old. I got to spend 13 hours on the road with them and travel how they traveled. I also remember playing Schlottmetz one time, which was a card game where the loser had to wear a weird-looking hat, and Grandpa participated, which made it so fun for all of us. He wasn't afraid to be a little goofy to make his grandchildren's day. We can all remember his dog barking noises and loud sneezes. Grandpa was so joyful. I'm so glad I had a grandpa who smiled a lot. I remember one time in the last few months when we had some family over at my parents' house and were sitting in a circle in the living room. It was a little squishy, but I got to squish in on the couch beside Grandpa, and he made a comment something like, "I don't know if you want to sit by an old guy like me," when really that was an honor for me. I love to sit beside Grandpa again and listen to his fun stories of when he was young and hear him laugh and make jokes. He never really seemed that old to me because he still had so much personality and did so many things that would be unexpected of a 92-year-old. That same evening, he decided he was strong enough to pick up Elizabeth while he was on the couch and give her a kiss on the cheek, only afterwards saying, "She was heavier than I expected." He did many things he loved to do, even though he grew older. Just like the time he and Grandma rode in my car to Chicken Jeff instead of in their own, since they were feeling young that day. Grandma and Grandpa's house was always a peaceful place. Maybe that was because they had to slow down, or maybe because they prioritized the things that mattered. I'm going to go with the latter option. I'm so thankful for the example of integrity Grandpa lived with and the heritage he left behind for us. I learned a lot from him, just from how he lived.
This one's from Trevor. I have many great memories of Grandpa, but one of the most special to me is how often he would come to watch me play hockey for the Arbroath Falcons. I remember Grandpa and Grandma even coming to my provincials tournament in Hamiota and spending the night. His love for hockey is something I'm proud to carry on. Yeah, this one's mine. Grandpa, thank you for choosing Jesus and choosing to be a man of faith. You've left a legacy of selflessness and generosity and incredible strength that I will never forget. I will always remember playing 7-Up with you and you banging your fist on the table, counting 1, 2, 3 to bid for each hand. You always started the count. And thanks for playing games with us grandkids. You were so much fun, and I loved your sense of humor. I miss you, Grandpa.
And this one is from me. Grandpa, I remember the time I got to pick you up at the hospital in Winnipeg. I don't know how I got chosen for this job, but I know you said Tricia could do it. When I got to the hospital with Grandma, I asked if you'd want to drive home. You said no. I was so nervous to drive you out of Winnipeg. You were the expert of city driving. I was still very new at it. You never told me to slow down or where to turn. You never notified me about a yellow or a red light. You just let me drive. This was so empowering for my confidence in city driving, and a life lesson for my future too. So much more could be said. I loved your quietness when we would gather eggs together. I always wondered what you might be thinking. Your willingness to admit your fear of mice. Turns out big men can fear tiny things, and it doesn't make them less of a man, and you knew that. Your yeah, yeah, that you'd say when there was nothing else to respond when someone spoke. The way you slurped your coffee while eating your sugar-free cookies. The amount of ketchup you enjoyed, and somehow you must have passed this love of ketchup down to many of the grandkids, as well as my son Harrison. Grandpa, you're missed. Your kindness, gentleness, joy, and smile will be remembered. Playing games with you is just one of many memories we have. Thanks for accepting people as they were and leaving us a strong Christian legacy to follow. We love you.
Well, you've been sitting there so quietly. Why don't we rise and sing our closing hymn? The Sweet By and By.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet in that beautiful shore in the sweet. I'll sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of the rest. In the sweet by and by we shall meet.
Well, let me pray with you. Kind Father, kind and gracious Heavenly Father, these are the words that my dad would so many times pray. We pray them again, and we humbly give you thanks. Lord, we have been blessed, and we give you the glory for it. And we acknowledge, Jesus, that you continue on, and there is more joy ahead as we walk with you. And there's joy in heaven when we rejoice with that. So thank you for guiding us through this time together and the blessing that we've had. And we look to you that you will go with us as even as we go from here. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Okay, so we want to proceed to the next part, which is to move across the road for the burial. Everybody is welcome to come. And after the burial, then we plan to meet back here for a late lunch, so everybody's welcome for that. After the late lunch, then we want to give opportunity for people that would like to share memories as well, have some open mic after the late meal. And so, for now, I'd like to hand it over to the funeral directors, and then the ushers will guide you out as and when it's time. We'll spend some time in the back as a family.
is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with the load of care? Precious Savior, still our rest. Solace there in his arms, oh, in his arms we'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there. Oh, thank you, Lord. You are my solace. Jesus, oh, what a friend we have. Jesus, sing it out, Jesus, oh Jesus, oh what a friend we have in Jesus, thank you Lord. Oh Jesus, oh what a friend we have in Jesus, oh Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. Oh, he all my griefs has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's a fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory, to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's a fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Earth holds no treasures but perish with using, however precious.
precious they be. Yet there's a country to which I am going, heaven holds all to me. Heaven holds all to me. Brighter its glory will be. Joy without measure will be my treasure. Heaven holds all to me. Out on the hills of that wonderful country, happy, contented, and free, loved ones are waiting and watching my coming. Heaven holds all to me. Heaven holds all to me.
To me.
Brighter its glory will be. Joy without measure will be my treasure. Heaven holds all to me. Why should I long for the world with its sorrows, when in that home o'er the sea, millions are singing the wonderful story, heaven holds all to me. Heaven holds all to me.
To me.
Brighter its glory will be. Joy without measure will be my treasure. Heaven holds all to me.
Jesus, lover of my soul, let me to thy bosom fly. While the nearer waters roll, while the tempest still is high, hide me, O my Savior, hide, till the storm of life is past. Safe into the haven, guide, O receive my soul. Have I none? Hangs my helpless soul on thee. Leave, oh, leave me not alone, still support and comfort me. All my trust on thee. Head with the shadow of thy wing. Plenteous grace with thee is found, raised to cover all my sin. Let the healing streams abound, make and keep me pure. To all eternity.
wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. Savior is Jesus my Lord, he taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. Transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. He hideth my life.